So I'm very pleased to introduce Marta Sitges. I know her from our time in Barcelona, which for me it's always very good souvenirs there. The best times, yeah. So we were working on, well, I've been visiting Marta quite often, also Ada, in the hospital clinic that you actually see there. And it was for the thesis of Nicolas Duchateau, which was already a thesis a little bit in the idea of Sergio, what Sergio is doing about trying to recognize pattern in echocardiography. So today I asked Marta to give us some ideas. This morning we have been seeing in depth like this very complex mental picture that you need to, that the clinician has in mind to understand all the pressures and to look for all the clues. And now I asked Marta to explain more what's the job of the cardiologist in the context of planning an intervention, and what are like all the measurements or all the things you need to check in the preparation of the intervention, but also what's the role of ultrasound during the intervention. So this talk is. But of course, I let it very free, so maybe maybe you're surprised about what I say. But the idea is really to have the point of view of the cardiologist and to understand what's the role of echocardiography in preparing and during the intervention.
Thank you, Matt. Thanks for the invitation. So I will try to give a hint of what we do as interventional imagers. They say it's going to be a new subspecialty now in imaging cardiologists. And what does it mean? It means that we are giving kind of support to cardiologists that do interventions. Okay, and these interventions differ from the old surgical interventions that they are done through catheters. Okay, so mainly everything is through a percutaneous access, and mainly involves two things, which is all the electrophysiology and the treatment of arrhythmias, which I'm not going to talk about because we help very little with ultrasound. They are mainly based in other imaging techniques, which is not the topic of the course. And I will mainly focus on what they call a structural heart disease, which I don't like. It's congenital heart disease or valvular heart disease, which means that they are treating things that are not the coronary arteries, which was what they used to treat percutaneously. And now they are treating things related to the valves or related to congenital abnormalities or even normal things like the left atrial appendage. So we will see some of these procedures, not all of them, and some of the things, particularly during intervention, which are a challenge for us as to give support, imaging support to them with echo. So the first procedure I want to share with you is TAVI. TAVI means transcatheter aortic valve implantation, or the Americans say replacement, because this is the way they can have more money for that. But indeed, what we do here is using a catheter that has a bioprosthesis. Okay, in it, it's compressed, okay? So through this catheter, the valve is delivered into the aortic valve, which is diseased, which is stenotic, okay? It's calcified, it's stenotic, and then what the surgeon used to do is take out the diseased valve and put a new prosthesis. So what we are doing now is putting a catheter across the valve and expanding this bioprosthetic valve. Okay, just ask questions if you don't know what's a bioprosthetic valve or whatever, I don't know. So we use two approaches. We use the femoral artery, okay? We use the common path, anatomical physiological pathways, which is the femoral artery, and going this way, we reach the aortic valve. And in patients who have a very diseased aorta, we have to go to a small incision in the thorax and then go through the apex of the left ventricle. But it's the same technology in terms of catheters, okay? So this is what the interventional cardiologist does, and this is done in combination with the cardiac surgeon. It depends on the specialty of the person who is doing the procedure. And this is mainly guided by two imaging things. One is angio, okay, and geography, and then the other is ultrasound, which is the topic. So here you have, I'm sorry because the line is in the middle, but this is a 3D image, echo image, of the ascending aorta, and you see here in this loop the guide, and then they are starting to inflate the prosthesis, and you see how it gets expanded into the aortic valve. This is a kind of nature mystery, because we don't know what happens with all the calcium here. And what most of the times happens is that the calcium is pulled out against the wall. And unfortunately, sometimes the risk is of some embolization of this calcium into the systemic circulation. So what do we use echo for? Of course, we use to guide the position, the positioning of the device, okay? So we tell, okay, you are crossing the valve or not. Sometimes these are narrow valves, so sometimes it's difficult to cross. We are guiding where to implant in height. We will see it later. And once it is implanted, we check the normal functioning of the valve, okay? This is an implanted percutaneous valve, already implanted and deployed. So you have a short axis of the valve where you can see nice leaflets here, opening and closing, and normal color flow here. I understand you're more or less familiar with ultrasound images or not? Yes? So you know where's the aorta and the left ventricle? Yes? Okay. So here, no, I'm just asking. Okay, okay, no, no, because maybe I'm, okay, so here in TAVI, I would say in the procedure of TAVI, with ultrasound, we have two currently two challenges. And one, the first challenge is when we have problems after the implant, and the main problem is leak, okay? That's the main problem of current TAVIs, okay? So surgical prosthesis have been very safe for the last 40 years. And the big criticism to these new devices is that sometimes the adaptation of the prosthesis to the ring is not as good or as precise as the one that is sealed by the surgeon, okay? And this leads to leaks, okay? Paravalvular leaks. A leak is some flow that goes in diastole from the aorta to the left ventricle, okay? Aorta, left ventricle. This is an abnormal flow, okay, and therefore should not be there. So leaks can be in prosthesis, okay, when we have a prosthesis, leaks can be intraprosthetic, like this one, and there is a simple reason here why we have this leak. It's just because the wire that holds the prosthesis is still there, so once the wire is retired, this goes out, okay. This is not usually the problem when the wire is there. But there might be an intra-prosthetic leak because of an adequate deployment of the valve, okay? If the leaflets are not correctly expanded, the valve may open not correctly and may not close correctly. So that's one of the problems. But the big problem we have is to quantify the other leaks, the paravalvular leaks, what we say. Paravalvular or periprosthetic leaks is exactly the same. That means that there is a hole, and you can see here, a hole that allows flow to go from the ascending aorta to the left ventricle, going around the prosthesis, outside the prosthesis, okay? And we have this color flow here in a long axis, aorta, left ventricle, and this is a short axis of the aorta. So as you see, some of these prostheses, despite the leaflets are of bioprosthetic or tissue valves, the stem of the prostheses is usually metallic, and they have some different components like nitinol or other that they do some kind of shadowing with echo. And that makes us really difficult to quantify this type of leaks. So we are working as cardiologists and imagers to see what's the best method to quantify, but it would be really nice to have this in a complete geometry or in a complete 3D view, but with high resolution, temporal resolution, because this is color flow, so the heart is moving 90 times every minute, and we need to have rapid acquisition of this. So we are using both the spatial, the space of the area that the leak is covering, and also the width of the flow in the long axis view. But this is definitely one of the challenges. And this is one of the challenges because it's not very frequent, less than 10% significant aortic regurgitation post-implant. But it seems that they have especially bad prognosis. So it's not clinically that frequent, but when it happens, it seems that the prognosis is even worse than in native valves. And as many papers have already shown, the related factors to that is precisely the geometry of the annulus of the aortic valve and the presence of calcification that doesn't allow an adequate expansion of the prosthesis, which the surgeon can correct by sewing or even taking out the calcium, okay? But if you are doing a percutaneous approach, you cannot do that, okay? So it's very important for us to plan the intervention and to look where is the calcium and what is the size of the annulus that we are going to see. Calcium, as you know, is not a good thing to scan with ultrasound. Ultrasound is not that good to evaluate calcium, and this is why for that we use a lot of CT. We don't use as much echo. The other challenge or the other important thing, and here we are doing a combination of ultrasound and CT, is the size of the annulus. Okay? At the beginning that was not so important because we only had one or two vendors of valves and one or two sizes. But now we have several vendors, I will show you later, and several sizes, so we are able to apply the most comprehensive study of the aortic annulus size, geometry, and also of the aortic root, because there are important things as the origin of the coronaries, which depending on the prosthesis that you deploy, they may occlude the coronary arteries. So it's important to look at the calcium, as I have said, mainly with CT, and also to look at the height of the coronary arteries. Why? Because, as I have said, we used to have only two vendors, but now there are more in the market and more coming. These are all the companies are investing in this because this is a disease. Aortic stenosis is a disease of old people, so old people with high surgical risk. Okay, so they are really very amenable to this type of percutaneous, less invasive interventions. So it's very important now that we have all this availability and the more we will have prosthesis to evaluate adequately what's the geometry of the ring, but also of the aortic root because of the coronary artery origin and all the geometry of the aortic root, to evaluate it to choose the best prosthesis for each patient, not only the size, but the type of prosthesis. So you know there are also some companies, mainly based on CT, some of them on 3D echo, that are working precisely with a lot of engineers, working on this planification of the procedure. I think this started some years ago, but now I think it's starting to make sense because we finally have several prostheses and we can choose. So at the time that we only had two, it was not really worth doing that, but maybe now it's the time to start to apply this kind of algorithms and this type of planifications to these patients. Okay, another procedure, if you don't have questions on the TAVI thing, we'll move to the mitral valve. The mitral valve is a little bit more complex than the aortic valve because it has much more anatomical components and also has a more complex receiving chamber or container, I would say, which is the left ventricle. So the container of the aortic valve is the aorta, which moves a little bit, but not so much, but the left ventricle, it's moving all the time and has a complex geometry and function. So the mitral valve is not only two leaflets, it's corda, it's the ring, it's the papillary muscles, and as I have said, is the left ventricle and also probably the left atrium function that also infers in the function, affects the function of the mitral valve. Our first challenge in the mitral valve is to evaluate it as we used to do with 2D, okay, but from different views. This is what we do in echo. Mainly we use 2D echo, you know, and what we do is different cutting planes, and these different cutting planes are integrated in our head, okay? So we have to do a long learning curve or finding where we are in every moment. So again, the mitral valve, as I have said, has been very well studied, mainly by surgeons at the beginning, when they started all the surgical repair techniques, and they defined very well the anatomy of the mitral valve, and not only the chorda, the annulus, the leaflet, the ventricle, but also the leaflets. So they have a systematic language talking about the anatomy of the leaflets. So we have two commissures, anterior and the posterior commissure, and the posterior leaflet, which is anatomically divided into three scallops. They are called the posterior lateral, or P1 we call. P2 is the central, P3 is the lateral one. And then accordingly the three parts in the opposite side of the anterior leaflet are the A1, A2, A3. So we have to be aware in each view of the 2D echo where are we and where is every segment. This is important because we have to be very precise to localize where is the disease part of the valve, because that's what has to be treated. And we did that job for surgeons, and now we're moving that for the interventional cardiologists in the cath lab. So it's important to identify, for example, there is one type of dysfunction of the mitral valve is prolapse, which means that the two leaflets, instead of touching like that, one of it goes up, okay, and there's a gap. So this prolapse is not usually affecting the whole anterior leaflet or the whole posterior leaflet. Sometimes yes, but most of the time it's located in one segment, which is the P2, is the more frequent. So it's important because the technique of repair is going to be different depending on where is it. Sergio.
How can you see that with echo? Which segment of the mitral valve is affected or not, or it's because it's calcified, or
yeah, how do you see? I mean, I'm not going to extend on the type of dysfunctions. We have several, no? But for example, I will show you some images. So if we see a prolapse, which is like that, okay? It means like the valve, instead of closing like this, is like that, okay? And this is why how we classify mainly the dysfunction of the mitral valve. So normal motion of the leaflets, that means that regurgitation may be because there is a hole, for example, after an endocarditis. Or you have excessive motion, which is prolapse, okay? Or you have restriction of the leaflet, okay? Which means that it doesn't close because it doesn't reach the surface of coaptation, okay? So this dysfunction can be located in all the leaflet, in one, in two, in all the leaflet, or only in one scallop of the leaflet. And that's important to be very specific because you have to treat that, okay? If you plan to substitute the valve with a prosthesis, no problem. You take the old valve and you put a prosthesis, but it has been shown that mitral repair is much better in terms of prognosis and survival and complications than wearing a prosthesis, okay? That's this answer.
So in the case you have multiple, like more than three scallops, relevant for the diagnosis?
Yes, it's relevant for the diagnosis and it's relevant for the treatment mainly, okay? It's important to locate exactly where is the lesion, where is the dysfunction. Why? We will see that, for example, percutaneous mitral valve repair, okay? It's very different if the hole is located here or it's here, because I'm going to push the clip towards where is the dysfunction, okay? And we will go to that with the mitral clip, because it's very interesting, the question, because for example, when we started with mitral clip device, I don't know if you're familiar with the mitral clip, we'll see it, okay? But we started only with central pathology of the valve, the easiest pathology to treat. But now we are treating commissural pathology, for example, or other pathologies. So it's important, because if you go with a fixed plan, like I'm going to put the clip in the middle of the valve, okay, it may work for a lot of patients, but for many it may not work. So it's important to treat, to diagnose it correctly, precisely, and to know where is the dysfunction and to treat exactly that. So it's not one size fits all, okay? So this is how we do usually. Most of the times, I mean, this is an example of a prolapse, okay? For those who you are not. So we do a kind of a systematic analysis of the mitral valve with different views, mainly using transesophageal echocardiography, and we are cutting the mitral valve across from anterior side to the posterior part with different imaging views. Here you have another view, for example, and here we are crossing the valve by the midline, okay, the red one. So we are cutting the left appendage that you can see here. The coronary sinus is here, okay? And then indeed we are cutting part of the posterior leaflet, the P1 segment, which is this one, the A2 segment, which is in the middle, and the P3 segment, which is here close to the coronary sinus, which is the posterior part of the heart. In the middle we have something, an alien here, okay? Something that is wrong, that should not be here, which is a prolapse P2 segment, okay? That's very advanced echo, but this is how we reconstruct the mitral valve anatomy in our heads, okay? So we typically use these six views, all the cutting planes of the mitral valve, to reconstruct a three-dimensional anatomy of the mitral valve to precisely diagnose where was the dysfunction and to tell the surgeon, okay, you have to correct this, and this is here, and you have to go there, because the surgeon had the mitral valve the heart arrested, and anything is moving there, so for him it's much more, or her, it's much more difficult to understand how this is moving, okay? Fortunately, you did some job, engineers, and you gave us these images, which are much easier to understand, but still, of course, they give us a lot of spatial relationship, gives us some additional value on top of 2D, but still the precise or spatial resolution is not as good as 2D, and probably it's never going to be the same, no? But with this we have some advantages. We have exactly the same view that the surgeon used to have, so we can, for the first time, we speak the same language. We also can see the width of the prolapse and look better at the commissures, so this is really helping us. And it's also important for color flow, not for quantification, because we don't still have enough temporal resolution, but it's good for location of the regurgitant jets, particularly after the intervention. We will see an example later on. So let's move to the mitroclip. What's the mitroclip? Mitroclip is the first percutaneous repair device that we had, and is the one most used up to now. There are more than 40,000 patients treated in the world with this device. And this device is mainly based on two things. The first idea was a congenital abnormality, okay? Some people that are born with this abnormal mitral valve that has double orifice. These are patients they are healthy subjects. They just have this abnormal valve, and in most of them it works well and they have a normal life, okay? So looking at nature, a surgeon this surgeon said, okay, if these subjects are alive with this, I'm going to apply this for the treatment of mitral regurgitation. The surgeon was Alfieri, and he proposed to treat mitral regurgitation by opening the heart and putting a stitch, okay, by sewing the two leaflets of the mitral valve, and converted a normal, one orifice mitral valve into an artificial double orifice mitral valve. Okay, so based on this intervention, technology developed a catheter with a device like a staple or a clip, okay, which is the mitroclip. And what we do is exactly the same. So what they do, I don't do it, I just guide them. So here we use the femoral vein. This is very important because puncturing a vein is much less aggressive and much less risky than puncturing an artery, okay? But then they have to cross the interatrial septum, okay? And then they reach the left atrium, and in the left atrium they position the device, go down into the ventricle and put the two leaflets within within here. So we have to put the two leaflets of the mitral valve in this space, and then when we tell them okay, they are in, they push down the grippers and the mitral valve is converted into two orifices. Okay? Your faces are scary, eh? 40,000 people not doing so bad. Okay, and this is once it is deployed, the catheter is retired.
Sorry, when you do that on the left and right atria, you go through the fossa ovalis,
yes.
I guess, and do that affect the contraction of the atria?
Well, we don't know. We've been doing transeptal punctures for years, and indeed we leave a small hole. But it doesn't seem to be very clinically insignificant. In Germany, I don't know if there is any German people, they have lots of money, you know, and most of them, they also close the hole, so they put two devices. I mean, but most of the people just leave the hole there, and we don't know if there is some impact on atrial function, because I'm not aware there is any paper.
No, yeah, that fibrous part, so we discussed it yesterday also. That doesn't contract, so for function it's not important, but hemodynamically you create a hole.
You create
so that
a
might
hole.
Be the problem.
Yeah, but what I mean is, I mean, should have no impact on atrial function because of the fibers, but I mean, nobody has looked at that. Okay, so we don't know.
In this example, you show how you can repair a prolapse between A2 and P2.
Mm-hmm.
But how do you actually repair a commissural prolapse with that procedure?
With the mitral clip?
Yeah.
Or with surgical, you mean?
No, with the mitral clip.
Same thing. You just tell the guy, go to the commissural.
Which segments are then involved?
Usually P3 or A3 or A1 or P1. More
okay.
Frequently A3, P3.
But not the commissural leaflet itself or the commissural?
Sometimes the commissural leaflet can also, but I don't. I remember several cases of A3, P3, but not of commissural. But even you could put something on the commissural and the anterior if you have support.
Okay.
But that's kind of more advanced
yeah, okay.
For very trained interventionists and imaging cardiologists.
Marta, are you going to discuss the evidence of benefit of this procedure?
No. I'm just, no, but I mean, if you're interested, we can discuss. I have another talk on that.
I don't
think
we can discuss. You're getting skeptical questions from the colleagues here, but I think the point is that there is no evidence that this procedure prolongs survival. There's some evidence that it may reduce symptoms, but I think it's still controversial. And the reason
Absolutely.
It's used in Germany so often is that the hospitals are reimbursed by a different system for it there.
Absolutely. But I mean, if you want, we can discuss about the efficacy of this procedure. But the reality is that there are 40,000 patients treated in the world. So I'm not sure if this will last forever. But what I'm sure is that the treatment of mitral valve disease will be percutaneous in most of the cases in the future. So that's for sure. So as the topic was kind of guiding interventions, but we can have another discussion on the efficacy of this device and much others, of course. So what does echocardiography? As Matthew said, we are useful, or echo is useful, of course, to plan the intervention, because it allows to quantify mitral regurgitation, and it allows to be very precise with the assessment of the functional anatomy, and then in the diagnosis of what is the dysfunction and where is the located dysfunction. So that we use that for selecting the patient who should go. Apart from the clinical indication, we have the anatomical indication, okay? We use ultrasound to guide the implant, and mitral clip and all the mitral procedures is the paradigm of the need of ultrasound, because there is no other technique, imaging technique, that sees the leaflets with this adequate temporal resolution, at least for the time being. And of course, we use it for follow-up. So going through the guiding during the implantation, okay, you have here some drawings. So what the cardiologist, interventional cardiologist, is do a transeptal puncture across the fossa ovalis, okay? Then we guide him to introduce the device. The device is 24 French, which is something like that, okay? And something big and metallic moving inside the left atrium is nothing. That's something to be scary, I agree, because the thin of the left atrium is very thin, so it's easy to rasp the wall and break it, and that leads to cardiac tamponade and some problems. So we help them to position the device in the right position and in the right hot spot, okay? And then, of course, we guide them to rasp the leaflets. Okay.
When the surgeon or the interventional therapist is placing the clip, how does he do? Because the heart is still beating, so the valves are still moving. Does he need to clip at the right moment, or
yes.
Do we I stop said, the valve?
We say now, and then he does.
Okay. Thanks.
So that's it. They don't like us giving orders to them, but that's life. So it's very interesting. It's very fun because we learn the mitral valve with the surgeons in the OR because it's the best way to learn about the mitral valve with the heart open and seeing it. And now we are teaching the interventional cardiology, so it's a fun job. So the first challenge here is to guide correctly where to puncture the septum. Why? Well, we've been doing transeptal punctures for years, interventional cardiologists. This is how they used to do hemodynamic studies, okay? But now this is a particular and a special puncture of the septum because the device is still very, very thick and has still limited maneuverability within the left atrium. So you're moving a catheter in all the direction of the spaces with like more than 1 meter catheter outside, okay? So the transmission of the movements is not that precise, okay? So they have to be very good in puncturing the septum in a good spot where they have enough space to move the device and not very close to the aorta because there is the danger of puncturing the aorta, which is a big clinical problem, okay? So what we do again is we integrate different 2D images, okay? We look at what we call the V-caval view, so that gives us an idea of the inferior superior dimension. We look very much to the aorta because this is our big danger, to puncture the aorta. And this is in another view, in another anteroposterior dimension. And then we have to make sure that the puncture is high enough to permit this maneuverability within the left atrium. So we have to guide a posterior superior puncture, okay? So it's not at any part in the fossa ovalis, it has to be very precise, okay? And this is important for the clip. And also now with learning curve, we've been learning that depending where is the pathology, so where is the dysfunction, if it is more medial or central or lateral, this puncture has to change a little bit. So this is why we are trying to also incorporate 3D echo, because it gives us a better relationship of the special, imaging of the spatial relationships. And also gives us a big advantage, which is that with 3D echo we can see the tip of the catheter very well. This is really tough to see with 2D echo. We see the line, but we don't see the end, and even of small wires. Okay, so this is an image of the fossa ovalis, and we have this wire or this needle. Indeed, is a needle crossing the fossa ovalis from the right atrium to the left atrium, okay? So once the wire is inserted, they put another catheter where it's empty catheter where they put the device in, okay? Es un carril, no sé. I don't know the name in English, sorry. Okay, so this is how we do. We usually, for this is very useful, the biplane views, biplane or views. These are orthogonal views that can be done with 3D transducers, 3D probes. And this is very useful because we have four dimensions. So we have anterior with the aorta, we have posterior, and we have superior and inferior. Okay, so with these two views we can guide very, not easily, but it's very, very useful to guide and to have more integration of information here. Also, we have to always keep an eye on potential complications. So this was a patient that we were trying to cross the fossa ovalis with these two views that I have set, and we saw some alien here again, so there was some thrombus in the catheter, you see here, okay? So we always keep an eye on potential complications, and we tell all the time the intervention is okay, be careful, give more heparin or more, or take out this clot, whatever, okay? And as I have told you, 3D is very, very useful because, for example, you can tell the interventionist, okay, you are touching the anterior wall. It's very useful for that because with 2D, we are really much more limited on the spatial or in the 3D relationships, okay? Once they have put the catheter in, they introduce the device, and then they start to bend the device going towards the left vent, the mitral valve and the mitral and the left ventricle. Okay. Here we also use this biplane or X-plane. X-plane is for Philips, biplane is for another for GE. And we use what we call this intercommissural view. So here we have the central part of the mitral valve, the lateral part and the medial part, and here we have the anterior because the aorta is here, and the posterior because the coronary sinus is there, dimensions. So with this we can tell the guy, okay, move the catheter more medial or more lateral or more anterior or more posterior, okay? So we help to position that because the cardiologist moving the catheters has angio, but with angio he sees very well the catheters and he has the orientation of the heart, but he doesn't see the leaflets, okay? So he has an idea where is the mitral ring, but he doesn't see the leaflets, okay? And this is how we guide this. So he positions the clip on the atrial face of the mitral valve, and then he opens the arms, okay? Once the arms are open, he checks what we call perpendicularity. Why? Because, okay, this is a 2D image of the mitral valve. This is a what we call a transgastric view. We have here the posterior leaflet, here the anterior leaflet, posterior commissure would be here, and anterior here. And what we need is to put the clip perpendicular to the surface of coaptation of the leaflets, okay? So if we are putting the clip like that, it's going to be wrong because this leaflet is not going to be correctly clipped, okay? So what we do is we guide the perpendicularity and we say, okay, you have to turn clockwise, counterclockwise, until he gets a real perpendicular position of the clip towards the surface of coaptation. Yeah, you follow? And this is something that he can only do with echo because they don't see the leaflets, okay? The only way to see the leaflets and the line of closure of the two leaflets is with echo. Okay, once we said, okay, you can go into the ventricle because this is perpendicular, blah, blah, they put the catheter inside the ventricle with the open arms here. And then we also use color to see that we are in the right spot, okay? And that the regurgitant jet is divided by the device. And then we go to challenge number two, which is to ensure a very good view for grasping, because we really need to see very well the leaflets, that they lay on the arms and that they are captured, as you will see, by the grippers, okay? And that sounds easy, but it's not that easy, okay? Because you don't always have this clear view of the leaflets, okay? And then he retires the catheter, look here, this was a rasping, correct, I'm sorry, because the line is in the middle, but the posterior leaflet is within the grippers, but you see the anterior leaflet has gone out, okay? So that was a failed grasping, and you will see here a correct one, okay? And now the grippers go down, okay, and they are in. So it's a challenging moment. You have to be very quiet. Sometimes we have to hold the respiration of the patient, because I haven't said that, but all these procedures are done under general anesthesia and intubation and mechanical ventilation, because they are long procedures. We need to put a TOE probe, and that's why they need general anesthesia, okay? So what we need is to have this view, okay? Put the arms behind, below, one question, let me finish this and I will be with you. Below the two leaflets, okay? Once you are there, you go down with the grippers and the leaflet is inside the grippers and the arms of the clip. And you finally close the grippers and have the leaflets in. Yes, question.
Can you reopen, reposition?
Yes. They can open, they can reopen, they can reposition. So there is one moment that then they retire the catheter and that's done, okay? There is a final moment, but at this point you can reopen, re-grasp, and you can do as many times as needed. But it's not good to do many times, but...
But both grippers work at the same time, they are not independent.
No, they do at the same time. At this time, they are doing at the same time. I mean, technology is changing, eh? But at this moment, they are doing at the same time, both grippers, both arms. Okay, this is the grasping, okay. I think I had, okay. So this is kind of the anatomical or the functional result. This is a patient with a prolapse of the anterior leaflet. You see that the leaflet is above the posterior one. The posterior leaflet reaches what would be the annulus plane, so it's in its place, but the anterior leaflet not. So there was a prolapse with severe mitral regurgitation, and this was the result, intraprocedural result, after clipping the two leaflets. So the third challenge we have is, okay, how was the grasping? So we made the grasping, okay, we took the two leaflets, but then you have to be very sure that this is stable and that when you release the catheter, this is not going to fly, okay, or be detached. So you need to know, the question is always a million question, how much leaflet is in? So you have lots of metallic things here. I'm always asking the people of the company to change the materials, but they don't pay much attention. So you need to say, okay, you have a good grasping or not good grasping, no? So one of the things that we rely is, okay, what's the length of the posterior leaflet, which is usually the smaller one, before the procedure and after. And we make estimation. Another thing that we are using is with 3D. So what we say, okay, if you have a good grasping and a good size of a good part of the leaflet in, there should be like some pyramid. I don't know if you are able to see it, but if you are only taking the tip of the leaflet, you are not going to have like that, okay? So we try to be very creative because we don't have a definite method, a reliable method to define how much leaflet is in. And always before we leave, we recheck because it doesn't happen so frequently. Sometimes happens this, that you say, okay, this is fine, the grasping is fine, because you have this custom-made methodology, and then, okay, release the catheter, we are finished, and then they obey you, they do that, but then you have detachment of the, because you had not a good grasping of the posterior leaflet, so once you release the catheter, the posterior leaflet goes away also. So it's important to be very sure that the grasping is good, that you have enough anterior and posterior leaflet in to avoid this complication. okay? But after all, 24 patients. Now, it seems a really scary procedure, apart from its efficacy, but indeed it's very safe. Why? Because it's a venous puncture, okay? So the only difficult thing probably is the transeptal puncture, but with guiding of echo, they used to do that without echo guiding, okay? Now we are guiding because it has to be a very precise transeptal puncture. Okay, the next question is, okay, is one clip enough? Should we put another? Because we can put several clips, provided the valve doesn't become stenotic, which is another matter of controversy. And as I have said before, 3D color flow imaging is not good for quantification. Images are really, really slow, but they are very good to precisely locate where the jet comes from, particularly when you have done something on the valve, like mitral valve surgery, in the OR, or putting a clip. So here you see that the clip is here, it's the same patient, okay? And there is regurgitant flow coming from the lateral part of the clip. How do I know it's lateral? Because I have the aorta here, and I have the appendage here, and the appendage is lateral. So we always use anatomical landmarks as reference. And this is the big challenge. We've been moving a little bit, and the clip has been also applied to the tricuspid valve. It's still a very, very small experience, but this is another big challenge, because if it is difficult for the mitral valve, apart from its efficacy again, for the tricuspid valve in terms of imaging is even more challenging. Why? Because the tricuspid valve is located more anteriorly, so more far away from the esophagus, and the image is not that good as compared to the mitral valve. Okay. Moreover, the leaflets of the tricuspid valve are usually thinner, so they are less echo refringent. Okay. So it's more difficult to see them. And finally, there are three leaflets. Okay. So here we need more and more three-dimensional viewing. And three-dimensional echo is still also limited for the tricuspid valve in TE, okay? So this is one patient we did, and again, we are trying to define which should be the methodology to image the tricuspid valve, but the concept is the same. The only difference is that we don't cross the fossa ovalis, okay? We just come from the femoral vein and go directly to the tricuspid valve, okay? And here the difficulty is for the grasping of the leaflets, because they are very, very thin and difficult to image, and two, because there are three leaflets, so you have to, it's difficult to be very sure where you are in every second of the during the procedure. Okay, so this was the grasping. As you see, the leaflets are thinner. It seems that they are out because they move a lot, and we will learn on the application of the device on the tricuspid valve, but currently it's a challenge to image the tricuspid and the leaflets in this sense. Another thing, moving away from the clip now. Yes, question?
Do you know if clipping has been tried in the aorta, for example?
That no, hasn't been tried yet, as far as I know. For the tricuspid, there have been almost, I think, 200 cases in the world. So for the aorta, there's nothing. Because the pathology is completely different. Usually, the pathology in aortic valve disease is degenerative, is calcium, and this doesn't apply to repair. Okay, that means that you have to take out the valve or put a prosthesis. And in some patients, it's aortic regurgitation, and there is some connective disease that you can do repair. And they are doing now good efforts in improving aortic surgical repair, but still very, very limited for percutaneous aortic valve repair, okay?
And patient who has these devices, do you need to give them constant anticoagulants?
Yes. Not anticoagulants, what we do is antiaggregants. We do aspirin and another type of platelet blocker, which is clopidogrel, okay? So what we do is we anti-aggregate them, okay, for the devices like mitroclip or the ones that we are going to see now, okay? for the bioprosthesis, like TAVI, we only give aspirin.
Okay. And for clipping, do you plan before how many clips, or do you do it during the intervention? You say, okay, I need a second, third. Or
we try to predict, but I tell you that we are not very good in predicting. Why? Because we are not very good in predicting the amount of rasping. Sometimes you have a very central hole, and you say, oh, this is a big hole. You know, we are going to need two clips because one is not going to be enough. And then you go and you do a very good grasping, you take a lot of valve in, and then you get a nice result. Okay, so we are not that good in predicting. We try when we say, okay, this probably will need two, but it's not always 100% reliable. What we plan is the strategy, okay? Okay, this is central, so we need to go upper in the septum. That's we plan, or it is commissure in the lateral and the medial commissure. We need to go more inferior and more posterior in the septum, and then we are just on top of the commissure. This is this one we plan.
Sorry, how much time do you have for the planning? For example, in the case of TAVI, you said okay.
Depending on the status of the patient. Usually, these are not emergent indications. These are elective indications. I mean, this valve disease is not something that you have from, it's not a heart attack, okay? So valve disease is kind of a chronic disease usually, okay? So we have the time that we need to plan. It depends on how much time do you have to make meetings with your team. Okay? So let's move to another gadget or another device. And this is something that was aimed to treat what we call paravalvular leaks or periprosthetic leaks. I have already introduced that clinical entity with TAVI, okay? So it means a patient that wears a prosthesis. This is a patient with a mechanical mitral prosthesis. You know that we have bioprosthetic and metallic prosthesis, okay? So this is a B-leaflet mechanical prosthesis in the mitral position. This mechanical prosthesis have kind of a cleaning system, okay, with flows, which are within the prosthesis. These are two small jets, but this patient has definitely a pathological flow here out of the ring of the prosthesis, which is a paravalvular leak. That means that by some reason one of the sewing points of the surgeon has been released and there is a hole, and therefore flow goes from the ventricle directly to the left atrium incisive. Okay, another example here, okay, and you can even see the hole, if you take the collar out. Okay, 3D is always nicer to understand. So you see here the ring of the prosthesis. You see the two tilting discs, MED, here. And then you see a hole here with flow. Flow is not as nice because of the temporal resolution, but there is a paravalvular leak there. Okay, so what we do with different type of plugs or devices, again, install into a catheter. We go across the femoral vein again, we get across the septum through the fossa ovalis, and we go with the catheter to this hole in the mitral valve and we put a device there, okay? We can also do that in the aortic position of the for prosthetic aortic valves. For that, they use either a transseptal combined approach or even an aortic retrograde weight, okay? It depends on the planning, okay? So what we do here, okay, these are different types of plugs that there have been in the market to close prosthetic leaks. But mainly, this is the ones that we are using. It's like two discs for the mitral position. For example, one disc is put in the ventricular side and the other in the atrial side, and they are pressed like a sandwich and they close the hole, okay? In the aortic position is the same. One in the ventricular side and another in the aortic side, and they are pressed and closing the hole. Again, here it's important to know where we are, okay? Here we use, for the mitral valve, we use a surgical classification again, and what we say is we use the aorta as an anatomic landmark, and we say the aorta is 12 o'clock, okay? Then the left appendage is 9 o'clock, and then we have the whole clock. So we guide the interventionist using this classification, and we tell them, okay, you have to go at 4 o'clock or 8 o'clock, okay? And that's very nice with 3D echo. We can see we can see it very nicely in this view, which is relatively easy to get with current 3D probes. We have here the aorta, we have the left appendage here, so we say, okay, 12, 6, 3, and 9. And we tell the guy, okay, you have to go to 7 p.m. and 7. And they're starting now to understand. Because again, it's difficult to them just being guided by the angio, okay? So, as I have said, it's relatively easy to guide where is the leak, okay, in the mitral position. Sorry, because this is not... So it's relatively easy to locate the dysfunction, where is the leak, sorry, but the difficulty is to see if they are crossing across the prosthesis or across the real leak, okay? Because there is a hole across the prosthesis, of course, when they open and close the disc. So for doing that with 2D echo is difficult, but 3D echo really allows us to see the tip of the catheter. So we can see now that they are entering across the prosthesis, and we can tell them exactly if they are or not in the right spot or where is the leak, okay? So for guiding mitral valve paravalvular leaks, it's really useful having 3D. And with 3D, if we have a good image, most of the things can be relatively easily done and safely done, okay? The aortic, okay, this is an example. Okay, you see mechanical prosthesis with outside or periprosthetic leak. Okay, so we have to go there, and this is after putting the plaque there. Okay, and the reduction of the leak. The big problem comes with the aortic leaks. Okay, the aortic leaks, because particularly for mechanical prostheses, because we have much more difficulty in getting good views. 3D views are still difficult because the position of the aorta is more anterior than the mitral, and the probe is on the posterior part in the esophagus. And also in the case of mechanical prostheses, we have lots of shadowing, okay? Which is more a problem here because the catheter usually comes from the femoral artery, comes retrogradely across the aortic valve, and sometimes it's really difficult to guide because we don't have this short axis view. And sometimes this is why we combine with transthoracic echo, where we have this also nice view. But here we would need a little bit of development on 3D echo imaging. And the good news of this is that on the other side, the angio is quite good for the cardiologist to guide this. So if we are able to locate precisely where it leak, then they don't need as much our help. And they are very guided with the angio. And I think this is the last procedure I'm going to talk, which is the closure of the left atrial appendage. You know, atrial fibrillation is a very prevalent arrhythmia. More than 25% of the population older than 65 years may have atrial fibrillation. And atrial fibrillation has the problem that as atrial contraction is lost, there may be ecstasies of blood within the left atrium, and there's tendency to produce clots within this anatomical normal structure, which is the left atrial appendage, okay? So to prevent this clot formation and the risk of systemic embolization and stroke, These patients are given anticoagulation, but anticoagulation has the risk also of bleeding. So one of the newest devices has been the introduction of these devices that occlude the appendage. This was also a surgical technique that the surgeons used to do in patients that were undergoing mitral valve surgery. They used to sew the whole of the appendage because nobody, it's not clear what's the mission of the appendage in nature, but it for sure it has a mission, it's not casualty, but they used to close it for mitral during mitral surgery. But of course there are a lot of patients who are not undergoing mitral surgery, and this is why we give them anticoagulation. So this has been introduced as a substitute for a potential substitute for anticoagulation, but it has not been yet demonstrated the superiority of this to anticoagulation. It's underway, but at least it's indicated in patients who have a contraindication for anticoagulation and who need it because they are in atrial fibrillation, okay? And this is the core indication we are doing. Again, the procedure is the same. We are using the femoral vein. So we then cross the septum through the fossa ovalis, and then we put the device within the left appendage to occlude it. There are several devices. This is the one that we are using, again, two discs. One disc is introduced inside the appendage, the other is just outside, and we compress it as a sandwich, and we occlude the appendage. Okay, for that, we need to plan if the appendage is suitable to put a device, and which type of device, and particularly the size of the device, okay? So we do several measurements with 2D echo, mainly the depth and also the width of the hole of the appendage. We use again several 2D measurements to integrate the geometry. We measure at different points because we have an anatomical guess here, who is the circumflex artery, and we don't want to injure it because it gives some blood to our myocardium, and we don't want to produce myocardial infarction. So we have to avoid the circumferential artery. We are using, again, biplanar or X-plane images to have orthogonal views to see the most three-dimensional aspect of the appendage. And we are also using sometimes 3D echo to see the shape, particularly because not all the shapes are circular. They are more elliptical. And that's important in sizing the device also. And then we use some of the post-process tools that we have to exactly measure the size of the appendage. They also use angio to size the device, okay? Usually angio overestimates a little bit what the echo says. And again, we guide the interventionist to cross the fossa ovales using usually these two views with the anteroposterior and the supero-inferior dimensions. Then we guide the catheter towards the appendage. Again, here the septal puncture has to be more inferior than the mitral clip one because the appendage is inferior. So if they put an inferior puncture, they go directly straightforward to the appendage. So we guide to locate the correct point. And then we guide them when they are crossing the appendage. That avoids using contrast because they see the appendage in the angio, but they have to put contrast. And contrast is not that good for the patient because it hurts the kidney. So what we do is they deploy the first disc, and now the second disc is going to be deployed. So we can do that several times, and we can even change the size, okay? If we decide, no, that was too small, okay? You see the first disc and the second disc. So the loop starts again, the catheter is in. They are going to deploy the first one. You make sure everything is okay and that the circumflex artery is not hurt. Okay, one disc, and the second one will come. Okay, and they start to push. You start to be scary, but nothing happens because they have to make sure that the device is well fit there. they are going to do that. And once they are sure, we are sure that the device is well located, they release the catheter and the device is left there. Okay? This is the final aspect. As I have said, it's like a sandwich. Okay? The circumflex artery is here. We have to make sure it's not hurt and that there is flow inside. And we also check everything is fine, that we haven't hurt the mitral valve, and we also use the three-plane views. It's the same than the B-plane. These are orthogonal views using a 3D probe, okay? And you also can have a 3D aspect of the device, of the disc. For this, the device has been also been changed. The first ones had an important problem here with thrombosis that we had. You will see it. So this is what we do in follow-up, okay? You see this small mass here, close to the pin, and this bigger one, it's like a cauliflower, which was a thrombus. After that, the company also changed the design of the device. This is already 4 years ago image. So this is an important problem for the patient because this is a big thrombus that can be can go to the systemic circulation. Okay, just to finalize, two more slides. As I have said, all these procedures are currently being done with transesophageal echocardiography because transesophageal echocardiography has currently 3D echo in all the modalities, and also, and this is why the patient, as these are long procedures, the patient needs to be intubated and mechanically ventilated, okay? There are other procedures which I'm not going to talk because of time, which are like putting an unplugged device in the septum to close ostium secundum atrial septal defects, that they are very quick. And now we are currently doing mainly with no anesthesia, either using intracardiac echo or using a very superficial sedation with a very quick transesophageal echo, okay? But what to expect in the future, maybe we will be using intracardiac echo for everything if companies are able to put here a 3D probe that is really useful for guiding interventionists. We use a lot this for making septal punctures, particularly in the EP lab, or they are doing just blindly with angio. And also other things to expect in the future are the miniaturization of the transesophageal probes that are not so annoying for the patient and allow us for avoiding general anesthesia, okay? And just giving them some sedation, superficial sedation, and not needing that. That's important in terms of recovery of the patient and, of course, in terms of some potential iatrogenia. Also, I haven't talked about this because it was focused on ultrasound, but also the potential, the big potential of fusing with other imaging tools. Like there is a fusion of echo with angio, or CT with angio, or MRI with angio, or other imaging tools. So giving the best of each house, of each one of the family. And of course, improving the devices and having shorter procedures. So just to sum up, an interventional cardiologist puts the hands, and we, with imaging, we put the eyes. In the team, because this is definitely a team approach. Thank you for your attention. More questions?
Any question? It's very nice to see the link between the different modalities, also to see all the measurements that are available, because I guess Hernan would talk better about this than I, but it's since there are so many devices now to be deployed, as you explained, it's interesting to see if we can, with all these measures from ECHO, start personalizing some models of the deployment or even of the flow after the intervention. So I think it brings a lot of very exciting modeling perspectives, so a lot of work for Hernan's team.
Yeah, and also a lot of for designing devices, because... Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much for this very nice presentation. I have a question regarding the intervention and 3D ultrasound. I was wondering
wondering whether the these interventions were frequent before the before 2D echo, just before, or is it, do the intervention are related to the operation of 2D echo, or before 2D echo you were familiar with these techniques and you just improved the techniques while the follow-up or the guiding?
So your question is if how was our life without 3D echo?
Is there a relation between this intervention and the operation of 3D echo?
Well, it has been very parallel indeed. Mm. But 3D echo is even older than these techniques. So we started to use 3D echo in the OR when still we were starting to develop this percutaneous technique. But I mean, nothing is essential. I mean, there's nothing you cannot live with, no? So, I mean, you can make it without 3D echo, but 3D echo really helps you a lot.
Yeah.
So by seeing the tip of the catheter for the mitral valve is definitely the tool. You can see it very nicely and you have all the spatial relationships. But also, it's not magic, eh? I mean, 3D echo still needs a lot of improvements, particularly flow-flow assessment and still for other valves like the aortic and the tricuspid valve. But when you have it, I mean, it's very, very useful.
But in practice, so you never make the intervention without 3D?
Not in my institution, because we have 3D and we, of course, always go with the 3D machine. But you can make it without 3D. Life is harder, but you can make it.
So Bart, you see that for once 3D is not complete rubbish?
No, it's just also to emphasize what you have partially been saying and also to compare with the other needs that we have for ultrasounders, so for interventions, what you need is good images where you see what you need to see and preferably artifact reduction and this kind of thing. That's very, very important. When you go to the diagnostics or follow-up of the paper of the patients, then it's like you need to do hemodynamic assessment, and that's much more data integration and measurements. So you really have two, in a way, competing things where both the imaging should be improved, but definitely we should also improve the data integration. But depending on what's the application, you will see that it's one or the other which is much more important.
Mm-hmm. Good summary.
Thank you for the presentation. If for a reason or another you want to remove these kind of the devices, the reason could be that the operation fails or there is a better technique and you want to remove that and put something else?
You need to operate the patient.
Yes, so you need to... How is there any possibility for extracting
not for the time being. The new TAVI devices, they can be extracted during the procedure. Okay, so you can re-implant them, but during the procedure. Once you are out of the cath lab, I mean, you are there with the gadget, and if you want to take out that gadget, you need to be operated by a surgeon. That's something that the surgeons like very much to do.
But maybe...
the design of the devices should take into account this kind of things, because maybe there is a new technique, and tomorrow you want to remove this and put something else.
Yeah, but Marta, maybe something, because it's an engineering public, it's like these devices endothelialize, as they say, which means that there's actually tissue growing over them. So you will never be able to take it out because you would have to cut tissue. So in that sense, even if you change the design, there's tissue growing over it and it's really incorporated in the muscle or in the valve. So that's the biology behind it. So that's the other problem. One thing is the device, the size, but then the biological interaction.
But you know, engineers may have a laser or something in a catheter and...
Yeah, but then it's a surgical technique, so then it's
something different. But you
that's in a way independent of the device, because the biology becomes important also.
Yeah, but I'm quite sure that the technology will be enough to do what the surgeon does with catheters, or maybe without catheter, just with, I don't know, it depends on you.
Robots.
Robots or whatever. No, robots is already there, but I mean, no, you can do ablation with a joystick, no? I mean... Brugada did an ablation from Barcelona in Milan with a joystick, so, I mean, science is incredible, no? So, yeah. But we have to motivate these guys, no? So, Alan? Yeah, the other issue, it's...
That sort of thing is just proving that you're clever. It's not doing any good to the patient,
yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, this is a another point, no? So robotic surgery currently is more probably a marketing thing than a real good thing for the patient, no? So the best thing you can do is find a good surgeon with common sense and good hands. But
there are some instances on the prostate and in the eye where robotic surgery allows much finer operation without tremor from the surgeon's hands that you cannot do any other way. But for most of these things, it's not necessary.
Thank you for your conference. Do you think in the recent future we can use echocardiography to give all of these procedures instead of combined with angiography? Thank you. Because the quality of image now is very nice.
It might be. I don't think only echo, depending on the procedure, okay, depending. It might be, particularly if we are using also fusion with previous CT or previous MRI, okay, because you will have the image there integrating everything. But still, and also still interventional cardiologists, we have to make a new generation with teaching them in echo. Still, at least in our country, they are not so trained in echo. But it might be, maybe some procedures, yes.
Okay, if there are no more questions, let's thank Marta again for the fascinating talk.
Innovation and you. Philips.